Hamisha Humshe Torah, Sefer Bereshit, Parashat Bereshit. Bereshit bara Elohim et hashamayim ve et
haaretz. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day.
Six foot, 8 inches wide, and 9 foot, 6 inches tall. So it's been my dream to do larger pieces, so this is exciting to get to do this project. Too tight, and oh boy, look at that. I do not like that. Oh, I don't like that. When I cover it with the gesso and it stretches, there's a few little wrinkles and stuff, it'll all come out as I paint the gesso on. A gesso, which is a titanium dioxide acrylic paint, and I'll put on 2 to 3 coats of hand primed of this and let it dry, and it'll be over. I'll get 1 coat on for sure today, and I hope to get 1 or 2 tomorrow.
Oh boy, that's really thick stuff, so it's covering really well.
I had a high school friend whose mom died, and she said, you know, my mom was an artist, and I want to give you this, and she gave me her mom's pastel set. So when I came here from Northfield, from the colleges, teaching 5 years at Carleton and St. Olaf, and moved out here, I was so moved by the landscape and by my children and wife, and seeing the beauty of life and light all around them, I decided to start painting the landscape and them as a new direction from these other things that I've been painting. And I started with her pastel set. And in the early 80s, I got my first paintings in New York at the Pastel Society of America. That's where I'm going next week, is to the Pastel Society of America. And here's 40 years later. And I called her up and I told her, your mom and that gift you gave me has changed my life, and I've got a reputation with my pastels in America, and your family was responsible. I had a great part in that, and she was crying, and I just sent her, I gave her a gift of a painting and a little story and a thanks, but that high school gift was how I started painting with pastels. It's gonna be good, isn't it? It's coming along really nice. It's gonna be a great surface to do this painting on. So
since 1975, Fred Sommers has been painting full-time at his farm home studio near Northfield, Minnesota. Most days, you'll find Fred at work in his pastel studio. Although he is an award-winning oil painter, his first love is pastel. His national reputation in this medium was underlined by his winning of the Pastel Society of America's 2011 Pastel Journal Award. In 2009, Fred was a featured artist in the Artist magazine, where he won first place in the Best Art of 2009 Abstract Division. That same year, Fred won the Prix de Pastel Award from the International Association of Pastel Societies. His oil and pastel paintings, known for their peaceful sensitivity, reflect themes from the land, whether in intimate views of grass, rocks, and water with reflections of light and sky, or in spacious vistas of the countryside, he seeks to share the hidden places of nature. The story leading to the commission of the painting Genesis begins in 1650 in Le Puy, France, with the founding of the Congregation of the Sisters of St. Joseph. For hundreds of years, the sisters flourished and their service spread throughout southern France. Then, in 1836, a half-dozen sisters were sent to North America, where they founded a convent in Carondolet, Missouri. Over a decade later, four sisters traveled by steamboat to St. Paul and established the Sisters of St. Joseph of Carondolet, St. Paul Province. Since their arrival, they have opened and staffed more than 100 schools and hospitals, and established more than 50 social service and spirituality programs in Minnesota and beyond. Their offices and residences are located on property adjacent to St. Catherine's University, which they founded in 1905. One feature of their property is the abundance of mature oak trees. The sturdiness and grace of these majestic oaks reminds us of the sisters' steadfast commitment to foster the common good through advocacy, creative arts, education, health care, social service, and spirituality. Their strength comes from fidelity to community, prayer, their practice of sharing the heart, and their celebration of the rituals of church and community. In 2005, the sisters realized that they needed to replace the aging Bethany Convent with a new residence for the sisters. Seeking to enrich the lives of older adults through a faith-based setting that respects diversity of faith and culture and honors the dignity of all, they hired an architect to fulfill their dreams. They initiated ideas for plans, and soon construction began on Carondolet Village. Working in concert with Presbyterian Homes, the sisters created a place where their dear neighbors could find and celebrate the joy of community. One key aspect of the final design was the preference to have extraordinary artwork for the village walls. Sister Margaret Bellinger, chairperson of the village board of directors, and the sisters' coordinator of the Carondolet Village project, describes what kind of art they were looking for, the commissioning process, and her committee's initial meeting with Fred.
We want art that people can stand and look at, and it'll generate a conversation or maybe a meditation. You never know, but something there will entice them to come back. And when they come back, they'll see something else. But we wanted that so that folks could interact with the art. It wasn't just something pretty on the wall. And given that information, Vicki began to tell us about the different artists she'd worked with. So she brought a picture of Fred's, what was then his latest work, Jacob's Ladder. It was celestial in its breadth. It incorporated a spiral. We didn't have the right words for it. So we said, Vicki, we'd like to meet the man. So she said, well, he's a little bit shy. But anyway, so she talked with him, and actually he did come. He was nervous, but he handed out a sheet of scripture quotations based on what the list, what his thoughts had been and what we might like. And so what he shared with us is some of his thoughts on creation, and then he had some of the Hubble spacecraft pictures, and he showed us those, and then he showed us wasn't a mirror exactly, but similar images from right here on Earth. And so in that painting of creation, it's the creation of God, but it's the creation that humanity brings to that and extends out beyond us to everyone else. And I think that was kind of coming from deep within Fred. He captured it in from the conversation, and I'm sure it was there already, but he captured our commitment and desire. So that's kind of how it came to be.
In response to the sisters' needs, Fred created a preliminary drawing. The composition is roughly divided in thirds: sky, earth, and water. The sky segment features a strong spiral element, while the earth plane is dominated by a single oak tree, whose branches reach up into the sky, while its roots reach down into the lower third, or water plane. According to Fred, the position of each element creates a powerful compositional dynamic.
A compositional dynamic, the outside edge, are powerful because we see a painting as a window that we look through. So whenever something touches the edge of a painting, that is a powerful area which reads foreground in a painting or close to you. So wherever I touch the outside edge, that's a powerful place. This comes and makes it right in one of the dynamic hot spots. So it's off of the center and in these positional places here. But this will be the most dominating idea in the painting. We're all the brightest brights and the darkest darks, and a lot of thing will be happening here. But this, so you'll have like color and form, light and dark, and all these things that will play against each other, so that maybe a small place with gold and bright colors will play against a large tree form on this side of light and dark. So that's what I've got to do next.
The first element that Fred placed on the canvas was a Fibonacci spiral. The spiral is named after the 12th century Italian mathematician that introduced what is now called the Fibonacci sequence of numbers to the Western world. The sequence is quite simple: 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, etc. Here, any number is the sum of the two numbers that precede it. For example, 2 is equal to 1 plus 1, 3 is equal to 2 plus 1, and 5 is equal to 3 plus 2, and so on. The sequence can be animated graphically using squares that represent each number. If arcs are constructed in each square, then a spiral can be formed. These spirals are found throughout the natural world, from nautilus shells to spiral galaxies. Once Fred laid down the mathematical spiral, he soon began to modify it.
This is a perfect arc on here for this design, and it comes in it. And it makes a dynamic force area right here. And I wanted to eliminate that powerful force right here and have it flow around and in. I just was looking at some Japanese woodblocks of painting of waves, and you could see, just by adjusting this, you see the wave pattern of water. So it was meant to just have this I felt was a nice flow. I operate out of a side of my brain that I just have to do some things that maybe just feel good instead of are a perfect math formula.
In recent years, several of Fred's paintings have included gold leaf. The painting Jacob's Ladder is a good example. As the viewer shifts perspective, the precious metal seems to catch fire as it reflects the shifting ambient light. Jacob's Ladder also features a golden spiral, similar to that found in Genesis. Creating the spiral and applying gold leaf is a multi-step process.
These templates are a change of radius of the first part of the arc. I needed to use these to place on the inside and outside to get a clear, accurate position of this this freeform arc or firmament arc that I placed in the painting. And I added some cadmium red light watercolor, and watercolor has gum arabic in it. And then I've got this gold size glue that's in here, and a little bitty of calcium carbonate, which is a marble dust, and a little bit of Elmer's glue. So all these things mixed in there are what I've made, and gold size goes. The gold will stick to this. So I want to be very careful. I only put it where I want. The purpose of these images are they are motifs and thoughts that I have about possible directions and parts of the painting of water, earth, and sky. This is handy for me. They're right here in front of me visually, and I can see them and I can think about them. I can move them around simply, and I'll be adding and subtracting as the time goes on. And these are images of a Hubble telescope and some water motifs, the edge of waters from different places. Here's another Hubble telescope and the Prairie Creek in the Nerstrand Big Woods near my home. So I've got a couple of pencil sketches here, and these are done from your imagination. You're thinking about positioning of some of the parts of the painting. And I felt earlier when I did the first of my Fibonacci design with the gold leaf, I thought that it came down too far past the center. So I brought it up in this upper quadrant, and I wanted to play the position of the oak tree, which is one of the main themes in the painting.
Of the painting's three primary elements, sky, earth, and water, the middle element, represented by a single oak tree, serves to unify the painting by connecting sky and water. It didn't take Fred long to decide on the perfect model for the Genesis oak.
I think this is the tree I'd like to use because of the stream running behind. Now, you don't see it, so I have to imagine putting water in this. But this tree has a beautiful canopy, meaning it spreads out. It's stretching out to get light. This is leaves we took off of the tree, and I see all three primary colors in there, and that's the only way you can really get. Often beginning artists will not see how much red is in the landscape. So to paint a green landscape, you've got to have the red in there. So you see these brown colors in here are flecking all through, and that is going to be the complement of the green. So it makes it have a special glow to it. Beautiful things I see is the way this comes out in a repeated form, but everything is absolutely beautiful and new and expressive in here, and the twisting and turning as John Carlson said, when you look at a tree, it doesn't fight with itself. Each of these branches are going up to have their share of the light, and they all share that space. So that's what you see here. This branch, these leaves are all sharing the light.
For me, if I didn't have those hours and hours of being in the field to absorb and to see and to watch the changes and the sounds and things, that to me is so crucial. Every time we look and observe something, we have a trigger inside of us and in our brain that I find these triggers that come inside, that light up places inside of me, are really true. And I've known about this my whole life. And I think that when that happens, people will, when they respond to this, will have a trigger of a place they've been, an experience they've had, and that will trigger that. And so that's what life is often like. We all have these things that we bring together, and the beautiful thing about this project is it lets me have those trigger points and those memories and those, you know, all those wonderful things that are a part of the joy of life. I wanted these branches to come over and touch this Fibonacci design right here with the gold leaf. We're talking about the symbols of heaven and earth touching each other, so this is part of, I thought that was an important compositional element there. The heaven part, the firmament part of the Hubble telescope, I just wanted the tree to go up and disappear and appear up in there, and so that some of the things of the outer space theme with the Hubble images of these galactic clouds that are billions of light years across, I wanted them to appear and kind of be like in a fog up there. So it was never intended that that top would be defined really well. When it goes up in there, it'll really feel like it lifts up into the heavens, and that's my intent. So right now, I am picking out the ideas, the materials that I think, and I'm thinking back to Genesis 1, and it said there was a garden made by God with the rivers running through to nurture it, and Adam and Eve were there to tend it. So part of this is I'm going to make a symbolic garden. This grouping of flowers and symbols from plants and flowers, and I've added this gentian here with a little bee in there pollinating the flower. So I'm looking at some of the color ideas that are in here. So I have some of the purples and greens, and I come over here, the greens are secondary and the red purples are more primary here. The muted greens of the ferns, I placed some of the purple reds behind to make them pop, but basically I want to get a shape down here, a compositional shape that will swoop down and across to the center. I'm testing value and color. So do I want more color to have it stand out? Do I want less color? And do I want this color, which I've made a choice? I'm bringing this up so there's soft marks in here of some of these same colors here, and then up into a darker family of the same color. So this will knit the painting together as a design, and those colors will make it feel like it belongs. So I have to decide which is primary, secondary, which is wants to be tucked in and hidden and kind of discovered. And so that's the next step. So I have a real good idea. These are some of the family colors that I'm going to put in there, but whether I want them brighter or duller, that's the next step. Thank you. to meditate or brood, that Hebrew word in Genesis 1, it says, and the Spirit of the Lord hovered or brooded over the waters or the darkness. That brooding is something that nearly every artist that you would talk to goes, I know exactly what you're talking about. You ponder it and you think about it, and it swirls all over inside of you. And anyone that's creative or inventive or design has that. And there's always a conflict with the side that organizes and puts everything together. And the organizer may look at the one who broods and thinks like that, the creative, as being not working all the time. You only have to see what happens when a conflict comes between those two, and the one who has the creative ideas pulls away, and the one who's the organizer tries to keep it going. And you have to have that balance in there. So it's a great blessing for me to have the permission to dream about this and brood over it. Part of the reason that it's such a great honor is in 1945, my family was in great crisis. And my mom went to a place like with these sisters. And I was in an orphanage for a while with my little sister. And that lady, Sister Elizabeth Olson, she came to my house for 17 years and loved on my mom and loved on myself and my four sisters. 17 years of love touched my life. And at the presentation of this to the sisters, I told them that story, and I feel like I'm coming around to a place of beginnings and blessings. And I can't tell you what a thrill it is to honor these ladies who are like Sister Elizabeth, out seeing value in people and loving and caring for people and sharing the good news. One of the things that I love about water is that it not only, like right now, it's holding floating leaves, and so you have a spatial thing of something floating on the water. And then when things hit, the water is making ripples like a trout coming up and biting some food on the surface, making these beautiful patterns. I've been using these more like the abstract expressionists. I call them color field. I look at these reflections of things that are out of the picture plane. For instance, I'm looking at the reflected water right now, and there are trees on a hillside, and they're bright orange, but they're reflecting in the water. And then the ripple of the water and things makes a beautiful abstract orange and yellow and green glow. Part of the exciting things of having something that's more abstract is I get to adjust it and to aesthetically play with it to create new ideas. So there is a number of trees here, and the leaves on these trees have already dropped. So it's allowing light to come in to the stream here, and the stream acts like a mirror and reflects the beautiful blue sky. So this time of year is a perfect color harmony and a complementary color of the orange, which is red and yellow, and the blue sky color. So you have the three primary colors, and it just makes for a wonderful mixture and an exciting visual image. So this is a special time of the year, and right now there's sky holes, which are openings in the trees that let the sky come through. And in this case, the sun is coming from over here, and it's hitting some leaves backlighting, and the rest of them are in shadow. So you get these intense cad yellow light, green yellow colors that are just glowing like a
stained glass window in Chartres Cathedral in France. They're just glowing like windows. I just love this time of the year.
I started in with these manganese colors, this wonderful warm blue, and the notes up in here and down here, and I'm tying together the top and the bottom. And of course that Genesis 1 talks about God separating the waters and placing the earth in there. So I'm taking the color in the water down here and then bringing it up into the heavens and the firmament area of the painting. I've been spending time with layers. I've got pink, purple, and a warm blue, and yellow, and so I have cool and warm blue in here, and they're some of the same color tones, so I'm bringing them down in veils, and I'm just taking these and just wiping like this on there, and this is drier from the morning, but when I just first lay it on, it'll soften. Just soften all the edges so nicely, and so it doesn't look like I'm doing much here, but this is a big deal. I do this all the time in Photoshop. Guys that do layers can come in and lay these soft layers. So there's just this soft, warm undernote here. The questions that get answered in life, when they get answered, are doors that open to new questions. And so these are kind of places that I just think are part of why I like painting and why I love life. And I would have never 5 years ago dreamed I would have got to do a painting like this. And now I'm dreaming dreams beyond the borders of this, of doing other things. And that's what the blessing of life is all about. What makes me pretty happy, man, is to think about some things that might come down the path that I might get to do. And some of them I have control over, and others are surprises like this. It's so easy for oil to be put down and then solidly fill like that. And I can do that with pastel, but the exciting thing about pastel is the way undercolors keep showing through if you want them to. So I'm using that technique right now to here, just gently wiping over this corner right here, and it softens and dulls this bright note right here, and it brings some of the greens into the tree. So when you want it to mix and feel like it's there, light is bouncing off of all the colors all over in the landscape. So last night before I went in for dinner, I darkened and punched this all up. Now I'm knocking it down, then I'll bring it back up, meaning I'll put bright notes and values. I took this and decided that this bright reflection of the yellows would be a wonderful backdrop for my dove's nest in the painting. So now the dove's nest was all alone over there for a while, and today I went and started clarifying some of the oaks on the oak leaves down in this and then up into the firmament and the heaven part, the sky part of the painting. So I'm taking the dark notes as an aesthetic, I'm taking the dark notes, these greens, and then making a transition up into this area and then making a transition down into this area. So there's a swirl and a transition of cool, warm over and over. So I have the cools here of the water in this part of the painting, and then they move to a red over in this area, and then to it's an earth tone orange, and that transition comes up into the yellow here behind the nest, and then it starts cooling again with the greens, and the greens go to the blues and the warm blues and then the cool blues and on up into the firmament part of the landscape. The color is done in such a way that you're drawn into the color as a subject and a concept. So you get to go into these places of color, an obvious and an expressive way, but also a seamless way. They just feel like they flow from one to another. So I changed the shape just before you came and enlarged. It was too circular. And by pulling this color out, just like I did the yellows off in here, I'm pulling this blue out into the dark shadow area. And then I'll go back into the shadow area and darken it again. I'll keep going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. A dear friend of mine, an artist that I admire so much, he did two portraits of Efmelius Chris Johnson at St. Olaf. And I asked him one day, I said, "How on earth did you do that right there?" And he went, "I painted there, and then I painted there, and I painted there, and I painted there, I painted there, and I painted." He didn't just go like that. So I'm doing the there right now. So I'll start moving this dark shapes of the shadows of the interior of the nest. I'll start moving them out again, and I'll be bringing the darks back in here and in here, and I'll start moving them in a transition, just like I had the color, the brightest note here, and then make a transition off to that side. I'll be making my darkest value notes here and make sure that they transition out away from the egg. So that it doesn't, it looks like it fits and it belongs in place. Let there be a firmament. So that's what I've been pondering in the midst of the waters. Hebrew should be: let there be expansion in the midst of the waters. That is just amazing to me. Let there be expansion. The firmament, or apparently the visible arch of the sky, the firmament, comes from the root word. Look at this. To pound the earth as a sign of passion. By analogy, to expand by hammering, by implication, to overlay with thin sheets of metal, to beat, to make broad, spread abroad, to lay plates, to stretch. And I'm up here last night
laying the third coat of gold, these thin sheets of gold. And then this morning I'm reading this. This is really amazing. Let there be an expansion. So that's what I've been pondering. So part of what I'm doing here is in my imagination wondering what an expansion of this beautiful idea. And I'm having these circles and swirls of gold and these images. And right now I'm coming into the last 2.5 weeks of the final work on this painting. And I have this time to contemplate and think about this. So that's what I wanted to share with you. I'm looking at this leaf, and I'm contemplating the next steps. Here were some intimation of the forms, and now tonight what I'm gonna do is I'll do a little bit more. This is the process of making music here with the painting. And if I would do, I mean, here again, here's the value of that. You can see, and that's even mixing in there. It's a very strong note, a color note. Artist and myself, how crucial words are to the forming of creative ideas. I have internal dialogue and talk with myself, and I when I'm here alone, I go, that color is doing this, and this is what I need, and how can I make this? And I talk to myself, and then I go, well, this is an option, this is what I can do, and then I go, okay, what I need to do is this next. So I watch students and I tell them sometimes they sabotage the creative potential in their life because they will say, well, this is too big, I can never do this, this is, so they have a negative kind of creativity where darkness comes in instead of. So this is something that I'm pondering, and I'm trying to make. I played Dixieland band in high school, but I wished I could play real good jazz right now. But the under notes and the top notes and whatever you call all that in a musical sense, I like that, and I like the delight of playing with colors. The Hebrew word for praise. Says to be clear in note and color. And I think that idea of color and notes all mixed up, I think there's something really to behold and to ponder. And it's something that I just delight to think about and express. Like my friend Rick Drake said, that musicians have time as their element and artists have space as their main element. And for the artist, it's to create time. And for the musician, it's to create a sense of space. So I kind of collect musical things of artists, I think, have created space in their music. And I'd like to think that I'm creating time. Thank you.
one of the things that I do is cut back. So I felt like this leaf is a very strong, I wanted to shorten it. And by controlling the palette knife, cleaning the brush a little bit here, wiping it on a towel, so that it's just as I want some bright, strong edges, and then I want soft edges. One of the things that you can see clearly there, while I define, destroy. It isn't destroying, it's pushing it back, hopefully to make a richer statement, and I'm trying to get this feeling of movement in there, which you can do with a movie camera, but I can't do it with the painting. But the illusion is what I'm hoping for. Artists would switch mediums, the paintings would not look the same. As a result of that, I picked up a painting style based on having the paint, what I'm calling dry, but it's more right out of the tube. Well, if you only paint that way, then you miss possibilities of what oils will do by having them wet. But one of the things that happens with a wet brush, when you touch something, it fills in everything. And with a drier brush, you can do a multi-layer texture. So what I'm doing right now is laying in multiple layer after layer after layer. And when I get down below, this will all start blend together. And if it's too strong, I can I can knock it back and soften it. But I had just gone over this whole thing and softened, and I lightened portions, and I filled in places that had not been covered with paint well. And now I'm going back and darkening some places. And then if I go right now with this other red color in here, that if it has a little bit of yellow in it, it'll just turn to brown mud up here. But tomorrow when it's dry, you can lay it over and it'll sit on top of there. And have a beautiful glow to it. So I'm putting this really rich darker edge here. So this will really accentuate the art. I think that sometimes when you finish a project, you may have observations afterwards that you're surprised about as you contemplate. And I know that this afternoon, when I got the call from my art dealer that she was excited and her husband's coming tomorrow to pick the painting up, I had kind of a letdown, and I know I'm going to be fighting that this week, of kind of a letdown from the energy it's taken to make this painting. On a personal level, a more spiritual level, to have my lifetime as an artist, and now I'm nearly 70,
to have this experience has been one of the greatest treasures of my adult life. This place is the place where the great woods meet the prairie and the heavens right here. This is an incredible place. And the place where the prairies and the woods came together, the oak trees lasted because of their ability to handle the fires that came through, both by nature with lightning and thunder, and the Native Americans, I hear, set fires because the springtime the buffalo would come and want to eat the new grass coming up. So to have the sisters ask me to do this piece and have the connections there, and then my childhood youth with a sister, Elizabeth Olson, that came to my home when my family was really hurting, my mom and family, and looked after and loved on us for 17 years. Was pretty special to have this opportunity now to honor and respect the life of these sisters, and it has to come to an end, and today was the day. Just said, I like it. I like the way it looks. I've been waiting for so long to see it, and it really looks. It's such a beautiful spot for the painting. The upper part, it just glows up there with the lighting the way it is. It's really, really nice.
Actually, the first thing I see is the tree. And for me, when I look at the tree, I see the tree, but I also see the seasons and the change that comes with them, and they each have their own beauty. And so that's where I begin. And then I do tend to go to the upper portion of the painting. And it's spatial, and it's universal, and it's night and it's day, into the whole beauty of nature and the whole changing of nature, into how we're just such a small piece of such a huge, we can't conceive of this universe, not only in size, but in its diversity and its beauty and its mystery. And all of that, I think, is there to be drawn on. And I see people going up and down the stairs, and there they are, just drinking it in. In some cases, I think they're, for a few minutes, they're in it. They're lost in the picture, and they don't even realize that that's happened to them. And then they are on their way, but they take something away that they didn't have before.
The sky and the nebula just draw me into it constantly. And I think I'll always find something new in it. So it's a very spiritual piece. But then life, nature is. it's really beyond words. It's something I can only just look at.
It just fulfills all our wishes in terms of people coming back. People, when they have guests, you have to see, and they take them over. It will not wear out.
This is the first time in my life that I've been asked to paint something sacred and holy, and this story of Genesis. And it's been amazing to me, and I'm so grateful for it. And you feel so inadequate, we who are human and we're finite, and then to paint something that's holy and sacred and infinite. But it's made me appreciate all the more this incredible place that we live in, Minnesota, and those three words that the Hudson River painter said of what they paint, what was truth, beauty, and excellence. And I can't think of a more incredible time to live right now, when the opportunity for artists all over the world to do this, and here in Minnesota, this opportunity is here present. And to have these sisters give me this chance to paint this, I hope that in some small way I'm an encouragement to my other artist friends here in Minnesota and all they've meant to me to help me inspire to becoming as good as I can possibly dream to be. And so I'm very, very thankful for this great, great blessing here.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you.
It's been quite a journey.
Hamisha Humshe Torah, Sefer Bereshit, Parashat Bereshit. Bereshit bara Elohim et hashamayim ve et
haaretz. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day.